broad topic, but Google Search as a business, purely as a business model, they actually have quite a clear vision for where they want to take it as a product. And crudely, it looks a little bit something like this. Google is essentially aspiring to create the Star Trek computer. So imagine the computer that Captain Kirk had and Captain Jean-Luc Picard, where essentially they'd talk into a computer and it would give them the answers exactly as they wanted prescribed back to them. Amit Signal 2 years ago essentially said this is the destiny of Google Search product to become the Star Trek computer, and that's what they're heading towards. So the idea is that you could ask Google a question and it would tell you exactly the right answer, and sometimes it would tell you the things you need to know in advance before you could even ask it, essentially. And in quite a number of ways, Google has actually made a lot of headway towards this goal. So the first up is OK Google, so Google Voice Search, the ability to search without the keyboard and search with your voice to an accurate detection. And secondly is the Knowledge Graph. So Google's Knowledge Graph is their big grand database of lots of information on people, places, products and things that can answer who, what, where, how and why kind of questions, essentially. And the third element is Google Now. So Google Now taps into your Gmail and essentially tells you what's going on in your day, what the weather's going to be like today, how long it's going to take you to get to work, and what meetings are coming up. And interestingly, Google actually started this journey quite a long time ago. There was a quote from Google's open letter where Larry Page essentially said that their original vision of Google would be you wouldn't have to type in a search query at all. And they did this as a joke in April Fool's Day in the year 2000, where they invented the Google Mentalplex. The idea is you'd stare into that crappy blue and red circle there, and you'd remove your hat and glasses, and you'd think about what you want to search for. You then click on it, and then it would show you the answer to your question. Of course, if you clicked on that, you'd just see a big April Fool's Day joke. But it's quite interesting how Google is actually, with all the technology you have behind them, realistically, you could see this being a real product one day for them. And I think a lot of the reasons why Google started to go in this direction is the shift based on how consumers now use mobile devices. So to give you a few examples of that, more Google searches now take place on mobile devices than on computers in 10 different countries, including the US and Japan. It's expected by the year 2019 that 142 billion search queries will be done on mobile devices compared to only 62 billion on desktop. So that gap is widening significantly. Secondly, it's been stated again and again and again, and you can see in this research by Flurry, that people prefer using apps on their phone rather than browsers, which is completely backwards to how people interact with a desktop. Especially with the boom of the internet, people spend most of their time in the browser. So it's quite interesting to see that shift go back the other way. And I think testament to that is products like Snapchat Discover. So if you're not familiar with Snapchat Discover, Snapchat, the popular instant messaging app, allows you to read interactive magazines and newspapers within the Snapchat application. So I'm not sure why anyone would read the Daily Mail in the first place, but it is possible to read the Daily Mail within Snapchat, which is, again, backwards to what I'm thinking, where people would either go buy the paper or they load up a browser and they just type in dailymail.co.uk. It's quite nuts. And the fact that this has been driving millions of page views per day for Snapchat Discover's partners and caused a 50% growth in mobile data usage within the application itself. This shows you how well this is working, and how consumers are preferring to interact with news and content within an application interface. A second example of this is Facebook Instant Articles. So you're all probably quite familiar at the minute where if you see an article shared on Facebook, you click on it and it just opens up the browser window essentially. And Facebook now have decided to try and kill off the browser and load articles when you read them on the app natively within it. And by doing this, they can monetize that content, but also actually provide a much quicker user experience, the ability to load articles up to 10 times faster rather than relying on browsers to load the article itself. Both essentially Twitter and Google have very recently, in the past few weeks, announced their own open source variant of this called Google AMP that will allow you to, as publishers, have code that allows the article to be served within natively within the Google or Twitter interface rather than people visiting your site itself. So I think all of this presents quite a number of challenges for SEOs and also people who work as marketing managers at brands. So firstly, there's now 1 in 4 search results that actually feature some form of knowledge graph panel. So 1 in 4 times, Google tries to answer the question you're looking for itself and encourages you to not click on one of those traditional blue links. And here you can see an example of that. So this is a search for merchant cash advance. This is essentially a type of loan here in the UK. And it's a commercial search query. and you can see that above the fold, all you can see is PPC listings and ad box, so a Google Knowledge Graph result. Secondly, a search here for Brighton hotels again shows PPC ads in the Google Knowledge Graph panel for hotels. So again, it's reflective of how the shift is changing to Google showing and trying to answer the question themselves, essentially. And as a result of this, it comes as no surprise that organic search clicks are falling, essentially. A study done in 2006 showing that if you're in position one, 42% of the time you would get that click. And an updated study last year showing that it now dropped to just over 30%. So organic search clicks are falling. And even more interestingly, Google searches for the first time last year fell also. Now, Google searches are still in the trillions per year. These are huge, huge numbers. And the dip is very, very tiny in the grand scheme of things. But there was 2.16 trillion searches in 2013 compared to under 2.1 trillion in 2014. And again, I think this is a reflection of people discovering content through app interfaces rather than necessarily searching for it. So as marketers, I think there's five clear things we can do to embrace this change and get ready for the fact that we're in a new structured data markup kind of world. And that's using microdata markup, considering to re-syndicate your content on APIs, using open graph tags, looking at Google Now, and also considering how you can create application-based versions of your mobile sites. And I'm going to go through all of these in detail through this presentation on how I'll show you how you can increase your own traffic using all these different types of markup. My name is Pete Campbell. I'm the Managing Director at Kaizen. We are a specialist technical SEO and content marketing agency based in London. So just to warn you, in the next 20 minutes or so, I am going to be sharing lots of different variants of HTML code. But there's no need to panic. I'm not expecting you to write this down now and remember each individual bit of code. All the slides from today's presentation are already available at this link. So if you want to take a note of kaizensearch.co.uk/SEOmonitor, you're going to be able to get essentially all the slides from today's presentation, including the code snippets. So getting into the depth of the presentation. At the minute, most of the internet looks like this to Google, a complete mess. This is in a picture of my backyard, by the way, my garage. It's just I just typed in messiest garage in the world, and this is what it came up with. So there you go. And because Google sees the internet in this way, there's actually a very easy way in which you could solve this problem, and that's using microdata. So microdata is essentially a form of HTML markup that's primarily used to help search engines better understand a web page's content, such as the company details, product reviews, and video. So if we're going to go back to that example I showed before and we pretend it's a department store website, at the moment this is how Google sees it. But if that site had microdata in place, it can understand, oh, we've got some toys there, there's some storage, there's some clothing, there's some cleaning, that's just plain crap, and then just some bedroom stuff over there. So it makes it a lot more clear cut and gives context to everything that's on your site. The challenge is 66% of the top 100,000 websites that receive the most traffic have no microdata in place at all. And to me, that's crazy. There are so many compelling cases why you should be using microdata. It can, based on our own studies, increase your click-through rate by up to 30%. It can help you gain rankings for additional keywords that are what, how, where, and why kind of questions. It can also help you lower your bounce rate by 10%, because the keywords that you rank for, the results would be so much more relevant, so much more engaging. And essentially, there are two different types of microdata that are currently leading the pack, and that's open graph tags and schema. Open graph tags are commonly used to inform social networks about your content, and schema.org is developed by search engines. And I'm going to go through how you can use each one in detail. First up, with schema. So what's schema.org? Well, let's take the knowledge graph answer for that. Essentially, schema.org was an initiative launched just over 4 years ago by the major search engines to create a common set of schemas, so encouraging webmasters to use a common set of HTML or JavaScript markup throughout their code so that they could better understand what a web page is all about, essentially. And there are two different ways in which you can implement schema.org code. Now, even if you're not a developer, it's quite important that you understand the two differences and why one would have different advantages over the other. So, of course, the answer is which one is best. So I want to do a little bit of a nerd fight and go through each one. So first, we have JSON-LD. JSON-LD is essentially JavaScript. And the way that you can implement JSON-LD is not too dissimilar to a Google Analytics code. Essentially, you can have a piece of code that you can easily configure, a bit like an Excel formula, and you can just copy and paste it. So you don't need to be a dev in order to understand this. All JSON-LD uses the same kind of code, and you can change it from site to site. So with all that, it makes it lightweight and efficient. The second thing is that you can take the JSON-LD code and just paste it anywhere in the HTML page. you don't have to modify any of your existing content in order to implement it. So it can be very, very efficient in terms of getting stuff implemented, because you can write the code and go, hey, Mr. Dev, can you just implement this for me? And then it's done. However, there are some drawbacks to JSON-LD in the sense that it can create risks of repeated code. So the way it essentially works is if you want to mark up a testimonial that's on your page, you need to display the testimonial once visually on the page and then for a second time with the JSON-LD code. So you can end up duplicating content within the code. On the other hand, HTML microdata is better supported. It has been around for longer, and it can address that issue of reducing the amount of repeated code. So the other drawback with this, though, is that it can make for ugly-looking code. You know, if you're a bit like me, a bit OCD about how you write HTML, you want everything to look pretty, and schema can devs don't like it because it means they have to take their existing code and heavily modify it, essentially. So the only person that can implement this truly is your HTML developers. There is no copy and paste ability with this kind of thing. My conclusion is you've got to use both. I mean, look how cute those dogs look. They look happy. So use both. In my mind, there's five different schema markups every brand should be using, from knowledge graph results, breadcrumbs, a search action box, blogs and articles, and also star ratings. So to give an example of each one, first, we've got the organization schema. So this is the only part of the knowledge graph that at the moment Google lets you have full access to. And what it allows you to do is display your brand logo and also links to your social media profiles. MySpace is included with the list here, so for those of you still on MySpace, then you're all sorted. Google Plus as well, whatever happened to that. And essentially the way that it works, as you can see on the next slide here, is on the left-hand side you have the organization markup. So this is JSON-LD markup essentially. And what you can do with this is you copy and paste this into any of the body code in your site. Now, what I would say is with all of this code, and if you're going to use it, you need to test it in the structured data testing tool. So if you're writing it yourself, there's a link there to the bottom to a testing tool which will allow you to validate whether or not it works. So on the left, you can see my code. On the right, you can see it's validated. And for each one of these, I actually have at the bottom of the slide a link where you can actually get the HTML code itself. So second up is breadcrumbs. So with breadcrumb trails, they're quite a familiar thing. A lot of people are familiar with them. You can see an example here for a client of ours called Choice Stones. And what they like to do is if you have data vocabulary markup for breadcrumbs, it allows you to create a prettier breadcrumb-ridden search. So a normal search result will just have a full ugly URL. But if you have the breadcrumb trail in place with data vocab markup, it allows you to get that prettier breadcrumb. And essentially it's a good thing to implement. The next thing is search action. So if you're an e-commerce brand, you're crazy if you don't implement this. It works a bit like Inception. You have a search box within a search box. Crazy. But here you can see an example of a search for Pinterest, and then it shows a Pinterest result, and underneath that you have a search box, and that allows you to search within Pinterest itself from Google. So it allows people to delve straight into your site. So the way this works is you need to have an internal search engine on your site. If you don't already, I would consider looking at a solution like Google Custom Search to actually get this in place. Next up is the article schema. So the way this works is if you have an editorial article, an editorial search query, you'll get first the normal kind of blue links on the page, and then at the bottom you have a dedicated search box dedicated to all the different articles that relate to that topic. So it looks like a normal search result, but by next to it you actually get the name of the publisher. So it can be quite a nice thing to have in place. And of course, to do this, you need to have a blog. And then lastly is the product / aggregate rating schema. So in order to have this, you've got to have a number of things. So first, you've got to have a database of customer information and testimonials. And you need to be willing to publicly display that on your site. So if you don't have that, you should consider teaming up with a third-party review provider like FIFO or ServiceTip in order for them to get in touch with your customers and ask them to rate you out of 5. So once you have that database, you essentially then need to either on a product-by-product level if you're e-commerce or on a service level if you're a service-level business, have a testimonials page that aggregates all the reviews on that page and shows what your average rating is out of 5. You can then tag that up with JSON-LD markup and essentially you can get there. So with all of these, I didn't want to kind of bore you through and show you loads of snippets of HTML code. The link that I gave at the start has a longer version of this presentation where essentially you can get the HTML code to implement each of these straight away. So next up is open graph tags. So here you can see an example of a brand called Jasper's Market, and they have shared on their Facebook page a link to a recent article they have. And as you can see here, it has a pretty thumbnail image, a second title, and a second description. And all of these essentially are open graph tags. If you have these in place, it can really increase your engagement with Facebook. So according to Jeff Bullis, if, for example, you when you do a Facebook update with a brand's description that's less than 80 characters, you'll get see an engagement increase of up to 66%. And so the other things that you need to have in place for open graph tags, you need to have an image that's around 1,200 by 628 pixels. And then with your open graph tags itself, so here you can see at the bottom an open graph title and then an open graph description. These really should be 25 characters max, and then the open graph tag itself should be no longer than a tweet, because it can also then be shared across Twitter too. So if you want to learn how to get open graph tags on your site, it's worth going to ogp.me, and that's the official markup kind of site where you can copy and paste this information. I've also got a link to the bottom there of guidelines we can get to. Twitter has their own variant of open graph tags. They do support open graph tags also, but they also have their own kind of variant of it. So Twitter offers two types of ways to get Twitter cards, either when you're running a promoted sponsored tweet on the platform or organically. So if you want to have these organically appear with someone shares your content, the first thing you need to do is get approved. And there you can see a bit.ly link where you can sign up and you can get approved for this. And secondly, there are different types of cards in which you can have. You can have a traditional kind of summary and summary image card just here, where you have an image and then a description of your piece. Or you can also have more interesting things like within a press of a button, you can capture someone's email address. Or alternatively, it will show a card which allows you to install your app, for example. So that's why Twitter cards are a little different, because they have that setup functionality to do other things outside of the Twitter interface. I'd also recommend trying Twitter card analytics. Twitter analytics is a fantastic platform anyway that's free, and your clients should be on there. But in particular, what's interesting is it gives you statistics on how your Twitter cards are doing. So you could, in theory, A/B test your Twitter cards to see which descriptions, which headlines, which images increase the engagement with your followers. So that's all the social networks and stuff you can do on your site out of the way. The next thing I want to talk about is Google Now cards. So essentially, the way that Google Now works is it relies on structured data within your email. So unless you're a brand that's sending regular email marketing messages to your customers, then this won't be really that much useful for you. But here you can see an example of Norwegian Airlines. And within their booking confirmation email, they've tagged up that email with JSON-LD markup so that at the top, it dynamically pulls out the information and Gmail knows, hey, this is your flight, this is where it's from, this is the time it takes, and it can save that information and then pull it in to a Google Now card. So at the moment, there are four types of Google Now cards. There's hotel bookings that allow you to have basic reservation details and business details. And you can see a link there, you get the HTML code. There are event tickets, so people can use Google Now to show their ticket itself and also get information on what's happening in the event. There are restaurant reservations. This is quite simple. It just says where you've got a reservation, when it is, and how you can get there. And then lastly, you've got flight bookings and boarding passes. This is probably the most complicated Google Now card markup at the moment that exists, because you can have flight statuses, boarding pass, you can handle multiple passengers, it can have multiple legs, and you can also notify people on the status of their flight as it's going through. So that concludes the kind of coding related part of the presentation. Next thing I want to talk about is how you can kind of re-syndicate your content onto other platforms. The first way I think you should be considering this is using notifications. So everyone is probably quite familiar at the minute as to mobile notifications. So when you have an app on your phone, you get a little notification that pops up saying, this is what the app's updated, or please come back to the app. And on both in Chrome and Safari now, you can also serve these notifications within a desktop application. So imagine you send emails to your you could use this to send notifications about special offers, your new blog post, notifying people their order has shipped, and loads of great ways to push people back to your site again and again and again. So you can use this API to get people back. GoRoost.com is a fantastic platform where you can do this. They have a WordPress plugin available and also one for Shopify. And they also have a fairly easy to use API where you can tap into this and start serving push notifications to your customers. The second thing is iOS 9's Apple News. So Apple News is rolling out in a number of territories at the minute. It rolled it out in the UK, for example, last week. And this is an interactive newspaper which takes loads of feeds for loads of different publishers. And today you can already sign up to become an approved Apple News publisher. And you can do that at icloud.com/news publisher. So again, this is a great way to engage with people who prefer getting their news and information through an app rather than a traditional browser. Lastly, the point I want to talk about is mobile apps. So this is a search that I did a month ago when I was trying to look to buy a Metal Gear Solid 5 for my PS4. And on the left, you can see the search I did on my Chrome browser on my iPhone. And on the right, you can see the application version of it. And I challenge you to see, can you really see much of a difference here? The difference is, really, on the app I'm logged in already, and on the browser I wasn't. But actually, what Amazon is doing is that whenever you're on their app, they're just showing you the mobile site. So they're fooling everyone. They're fooling the 86% of people who are in an app, like they're getting a dedicated experience just for them, when really what they're seeing is the mobile site. Another example of that here in the UK, and actually across a lot of territories, is Pizza Hut. Pizza Hut do the exact same thing. If you have the Pizza Hut app, to me, when I'm ordering a pizza, I think, oh, I better use the app on my phone. I'm actually just looking at their mobile site. So when you think about that as a concept, it's actually relatively easy for you to reskin your mobile site and turn it into an app if you are the kind of business that has a recurring customer base. And the way in which you can do this is using an open source framework. So in particular, PhoneGap is an open source framework that allows you to build cross-platform mobile sites that are available to be used on iOS and Android devices. But you can also try Cordova to implement the same. So this is very heavy on the dev front, but it allows you to tap into that 86% of people who aren't bothering to open up their browser when you're on your mobile device. So that kind of brings me to the end of my presentation, and I think it's quite clear to say that if you don't implement all of these things, microdata markup, resyndicating your content, open graph tags, Google Now cards, and considering having an app version of your site, you're not going to be ready for the Star Trek computer that's increasingly becoming more and more prominent as we see the going away of traditional blue links and Google trying to serve answers natively within their application. And I promise if you implement all of this, you'll get at least 1 million visits. And if you choose to not listen to me and ignore all of my recommendations, then you can always try this guy as a backup plan. This is someone who regularly emails me about how he apparently has amazing traffic software and it will bring great traffic to my sites day and night, and it's really fast. And my favorite line is this: no harm your sites, trust me. So what I would say is the choice is yours. So thank you for listening to my presentation. You can get a link to my slides at kaizensearch.co.uk/SEOmonitor. And I'm happy to take any questions now or over email or Twitter or whatever works for you, essentially. Thank you very much.